Good evening. Sorry. My name is Michael Denisha. I'm Associate Director of the John Bradamus Center of New York University, named for former Congressman and NYU President Emeritus John Bradamus. The center explores public policy issues in education, the arts and humanities, international cultural engagement, as well as Congress, politics, and foreign relations. And we're very pleased to be sponsoring tonight's event here at NYU Washington, D.C. Nothing brings a crowd together quite like the offer of free, delicious food. But in all seriousness, food does bring people together in a very unique way. And that's what we're here to talk about tonight. So first we'll feed the mind, and then later we'll feed the body. Our topic, culinary diplomacy, make food, not war, was first suggested by one of our panelists who collaborated with us in planning tonight's event, Dr. Zoe Cosmidou of the Hellenic Foundation for Culture. Zoe currently holds the presidency of the Washington Network of the National Institutes for Culture from EU member states, known as UNIQUE, and they are our co-sponsor tonight. Zoe, can I ask you to say a few words about UNIQUE?
Sure, of course.
Is it working?
Yeah. Well, I would like to thank our host today, NYU, and especially the John Bradamus Center, that not only accepted and liked the idea, but they embraced it with all their kindness and heart and offered to host the event here. So we're very grateful for that. And I would like to thank in particular Tom McIntyre and of course Michael Dinucci. I hope I pronounced it well.
You're getting there.
And I would like to thank you also for coming from New York every time we had a meeting here and every discussion you had to travel back and forth. And we're very grateful for your wholehearted hosting. I would like to say a few words about UNIQUE. It's not exactly pronounced UNIQUE, but it sounds like it is being UNIQUE because it is UNIQUE. And it's actually the acronym for the European Union National Institutes for Culture, which is a network of about national institutes from each European Union member state across 90 countries around the planet. EU is the largest cultural group in Washington, D.C., and it is represented by embassy cultural counselors and by national cultural institutes from the EU member countries. UNIQUE is a network of the national institutes for culture, and their presence here aims to contribute to cultural diversity inside and outside of the European Union, and to strengthen cultural dialogue and exchange. UNIQUE is holding once a year, every year, the presidency of the rest of the members. And we usually organize events, joint events, like this one that we are participating today. So it's this year's presidency is held by the Hellenic Foundation for Culture, which I represent, and it is a Greek foundation for culture that organizes a series of events dedicated to cultural and especially culinary diplomacy. This is our first one, and we're very grateful once again for not only the hosting, but also the panelists who, the very distinguished panelists, I have to say, who are here today to honor us with their presence and to enlighten us with their knowledge and experience. So thank you again, all of you, and each one of you.
Thank you, Zoe. Before we go on, I'd like to also thank Michele Giacalone of the Italian Cultural Institute, who helped pull tonight's event together with us, and especially Nuska Zakrajic of the Slovenian Embassy for arranging the cooking demonstration by the school children upstairs. The students from the Kumar Elementary School in Slovenia did such a fantastic job, and it's a really remarkable program that they take part in, so we were really glad to have them here with us. Following our discussions down here, I hope you'll join us upstairs for a reception on the first floor in the lobby. The Austrian Cultural Forum and the restaurant Kapnos and its executive chef, George Pagonis, have generously provided us some treats to enjoy. Just one change to the program. Unfortunately, Todd Gray is unable to join us tonight, but we have an excellent group on our panel, and we're very lucky to have as moderator Dr. Joanna Mendelson-Forman. Joanna is scholar in residence at American University, where she teaches the course Conflict Cuisine, An Introduction to War and Peace Around the Dinner Table. She's one of the most knowledgeable writers and practitioners on the issues of food and conflict and of food as soft power. And she has a distinguished career I can't do justice to here, so I direct everyone to read her bio in your program, along with the bios of everyone else here. I can think of no one better prepared to serve as our guide for our culinary and diplomatic tour tonight, and so I turn everything over to Joanna.
Well, thank you, Michael, for that kind introduction. Thank you, Zoe, for thinking about putting this panel together through Unique. It is an honor to be sitting here in NYU's beautiful headquarters in Washington, D.C., and particularly wonderful is to be with so many talented women who are in many ways the mentors of my own interest in this field, starting with Ambassador Capricia Marshall, Ms. Lauren Bernstein of the State Department, Patty Hinnich, who has been a role model in many ways of a Latin Americanist who turned to a chef, and of course Zoe, who is a graduate of American University, I think, as well, and a great supporter of work that we do. So thank you, ladies, for all being here, because cooking, as you know, is a team sport, and also conflict is a team sport. We build peace one plate at a time. But you know, there's a saying in Washington, D.C., and it still exists, that you could always tell where the United States was at war by where a new ethnic restaurant would open up. I remember when I first lived here in the 80s and the Cold War was going on, the Vietnamese restaurants in Arlington became a center of attention, not only because the diaspora of Vietnam came after the fall of Saigon, but because it became a center where the newly arrived Southeast Asians were able to integrate. And then the Afghan restaurants started opening up after 1979 when the Russians invaded that country. And little did we know that on 9th Street, Ethiopia would find itself at the doors of our city when we had Little Ethiopia and thousands of Ethiopians who were fleeing a dictatorship and also famine wound up in our city. And of course, then the wars in Central America, the last wars of the Cold War actually happened, and we had pupuserias in every jurisdiction from D.C. to Virginia to Maryland, and they still are a dominant part of our cuisine. From El Salvador, Nicaragua, Guatemala, we have a large diaspora of Latinos here, in addition, of course, to our wonderful Mexicans, and thanks to Patty, we now have wonderful Mexican cooking in this city. But we are a city of many diasporas and many cuisines. And I think in the world we live in, where we are filled with information about people starving to death, the inability to have access to food, the fact that food becomes a political problem. Just look at what's going on in Syria today, where you have a dictator bombing people standing in lines for to get bread, because that's a place that everybody knows women and children line up. We have some really difficult problems and difficult conflicts. But at the core of all these conflicts is something that you often forget. Like breathing, we have to eat. And food becomes central to that activity, whether you're in a war zone or in rebuilding your society. And that is often the glue that holds societies together. So in thinking about this, the kitchen really has become a venue of foreign policy. And when you think about the kitchen as a venue of foreign policy, we're not the only ones who thought about it. Ambassador Marshall, who served in the State Department with Secretary Clinton, was one of the key implementers of a policy that our Secretary of State in 2012 started, creating culinary diplomacy as a form of smart power. In the order of speaking, I'd like Ambassador Marshall to tell us a little bit about that wonderful effort, and then we're going to be followed by Lauren Bernstein in the Office of Protocol at the State Department, who can elaborate on some of the activities that our American Chef Corps is doing. Of course, we'll be followed by Patty Hinnich, who is always terrific, because as a chef, something very interesting came up. At the International Association of Culinary Professionals, where you talked a few weeks ago, there was a survey, and you know who Americans trust the most? Chefs. Chefs are more trusted than politicians. Well, that's not hard. But chefs are trusted because think about this. You go into a restaurant, somebody puts food in front of you, and you eat it. You believe that the sanitation is fine, the food may not be of your liking, but you trust that individual. And interestingly, because of the media, and Patty has her own show she'll tell you about, chefs have become elevated to a new stardom, not only because they're on Chopped or they bake cupcakes, but because they represent something that we all agree we need, food, and that we all trust. So think about it when you listen to Patty and his talk, that whom do you trust? A chef? I think I do. And even around the world, chefs are venerated. And then, of course, we're going to finish this panel, but of course, we're going to have you talk and ask questions as well. Zoe, who has been a tremendous influence in the development of cultural diplomacy as a practitioner, first at the Embassy of Greece and now working with the European Union, will tell us a little bit not only about how cultural diplomacy works and where food fits into this, but she has just come back from the Milan Expo. How many of you know that there is a World's Fair in Milan? Good, good. And do you know what the theme is? Food. Feed the future, food for the future. And do you know that the U.S. has a pavilion? So, and many other countries do too, and Zoe will talk a little bit about that. So I'm not going to disturb anybody any further with my remarks, but I'd love to ask the ambassador if she could tell us a little bit about the origins of culinary diplomacy in the State Department and where you see it going.
Well, first I'd like to say thank you for inviting me to be a part of this esteemed panel. In particularly on Cinco de Mayo, where we're celebrating a lot of
Let's give it for Mexican food.
Yeah, and
Cinco de Mayo
to NYU. Thank you so very much for hosting this. And I recently left my posting as chief of protocol, and I reflect back and I'm very, very sad about that because it was the job of a lifetime, as you well know, Johanna. I also want to take your course, by the way. It sounds fantastic. So sign me up.
Rated number one by Mashable. As something, parents shouldn't see this, but it was apparently noted today that in unconventional college courses that scream college, this was listed. So for better or worse, if you're paying the tuition, you have to watch out here at NYU.
Excellent. Well, like I said, sign me up. I felt as though I had prepared for this posting ever since I was a little girl in my grandmother's kitchen. I'm first generation Mexican Croatian American, and you know, you got the privilege of stirring the mole in my abuela's kitchen. And you know, I thought about when I became chief of protocol was, you know, how do we use culture? How what are we talking about the American culture, our traditions, our people? How are we expressing that in everything that we do? And there was a sort of a catalyst that preceded the creation of the diplomatic culinary partnership. I was at what we call a working bilateral luncheon with Secretary Clinton. I can't recall the other country, but it didn't quite matter because, you know, as we have these working luncheons, are one side of the table are all Americans and the other side are foreign visiting guests. Well, this is one of the first ones that we put on, and I wanted to make sure that everything was going according to plan, you know, that the plates came out on time, that everyone was seated in the right place. And so people were seated, the food came out, and Secretary Clinton looked at the food. She gave me one of those glances. She looked back at the food. Without a word, I knew exactly what she was saying. Does this express American culinary experience? And I knew we can do better. You know, there was a little chicken, there may have been something that looked like vegetables on the plate and a little bit of rice, but it did not say anything about who we were, you know, and how were we welcoming the, you know, our visitors here to the United States. And then shortly thereafter, I had very quickly another experience. President Obama was hosting President Abbas of Palestine and Prime Minister Netanyahu for a trilateral. Very important. Again, all the details mattered. You know, where were they seated? How were the flags? I'm a bit of a flag, I think they called me the flag freak, because I always wanted to make sure that flags were hung appropriately. You know, it's a symbol of a person, of every country. And so I was looking at all of those details, but yet again, you know, this is a four-hour trilateral. And one enormous element that was missing was food. And so Prime Minister Netanyahu comes up to me and he says, Kalrisha, we have been here for so long. We have been here for hours now. Can I have a cookie? Can I have a cup of coffee? Something. And I had to pause and think, oh my goodness, we have not fed these people. I mean, beyond wanting to express, you know, something wonderful about our country, we actually have to feed people. I mean, it's a very important element. And so, of course, I scrambled and we got something together and we made sure that they were fed. But the next time that he arrived for his bilateral with Secretary Clinton, I had freshly ground hummus. I had very strong, wonderful coffee the way that he liked it. It was all specially prepared. I felt so good. And he said, thank you, Kapisha, you remembered. And they do. They remember. They remember those moments. And so I went back to the office, went to the team, said, guys, let's all sit around and think about this. We've got to do something with food. We have too many engagements. We're missing opportunities. And we created then the Diplomatic Culinary Partnership. And a partnership because we wanted this to be a private-public engagement. It wasn't about the US government having to create another budget line. We didn't want that. We wanted to make sure that we were bringing in new partners, that we had excited outside friends who were going to help us build this opportunity, new opportunity to showcase, as I say, the best of America, our best of our culinary experience here. And we did that. In particular, we brought in the James Beard Foundation, and they were wonderful. Great, great partner. But then so many others came with them and found that this was a wonderful way in which they can participate in the efforts of our bilateral experience in the United States. And then beyond that, we said, gosh, we have a great resource that we're not utilizing, these chefs. We have the best chefs. I mean, the best chefs now. It used to be, you know, the French and the Italians, and I'm sorry, but we think now we have some amazing chefs. And so we said, let's bring that resource in. And we created the American Chef Corps. And we already had Jose Andres, who was helping out with the cook stove experience at the State Department. We had the White House chef and Sam Cass. And now we have this fantastic White House chef, who is the first woman to be a White House chef, Chris Comerford. I worked with her when I was in the Clinton administration. She had been hired then. And so we thought, let's use all of them in this resource. And so we did. And one of our first engagements was when Vice President Biden and Secretary Clinton invited then Vice President Xi Jinping for a state luncheon. Now, it wasn't quite a state luncheon, but because he wasn't head of state yet, but it was of that size and that grandeur. And we then asked Ming Tsai of Boston to come and create the culinary experience for him, create this wonderful Chinese and US experience. And it was phenomenal. In the outside anteroom, just before I was escorting Vice President Xi Jinping into the room, he was standing there next to Secretary Clinton, and Secretary Clinton introduced Ming Tsai to the Vice President. And at that moment, I knew we did the right thing. His eyes just lit up. He was so honored, he was so touched that we had presented this very special gesture, that this was going to be not just a luncheon, but an extraordinary luncheon. And the two of them started to engage in Mandarin. No one could keep up with them. The interpreters were trying, and they couldn't quite keep up with them. But you could tell there was a real connection. And that's what we were looking for. That's specifically what we were looking for. We wanted that spark. We wanted to say to them, we are inviting you to the United States. We know you're going to engage in difficult issues. We're not all of these talks are going to be friendly talks. But when we welcome you, we welcome you with open arms as our friend. And we want to make sure that you feel respected and you feel honored. And I knew at that moment that we really hit the nail on the head. And in the government, for those who have worked there, you know that you have to create a structure. You have to make sure that there are offices and great people to continue the work that you've started. And I was thrilled that then the wonderful Lauren Bernstein had walked into our office And I said, what do you think about food? What do you think about chefs? And she was like, yes. She had a great passion for it. And so we brought her on into our endeavor, and she has just taken it, and she has ran with it. And I'm so proud of what you have done with this program to date. It's been wonderful to watch. So that was really the birth of it.
Well, and I think one of the amazing parts of this whole culinary diplomacy phenomena is that it's made the French tweet out over and over again that they invented culinary diplomacy. In fact, the minister is very upset. There have been some tweets that have come out that they are the inventors of culinary diplomacy. Every time there's something about a chef's court come out, if you follow the Twitter feed, actually, I think it was the court of Catherine the Great in Russia that did culinary diplomacy, mm-hmm. and everybody fights about it. But I think those are the kinds of conflicts we want to generate.
Absolutely.
Don't you think, Lauren?
Absolutely.
So you were just telling me in the green room a little bit about how people now are really calling you as other areas of the world open up, such as Cuba. But I think it would be interesting from your point of view sitting in the protocol office to talk a little bit more and develop what Ambassador Marshall was talking about how the program works. But I also love your anecdote about everybody wanting to take a trip to Cuba. So,
Well, thank you. And thank you for having me. And I have to say thank you to this woman to my right who gave me the best job in the city or in the country. It is such an honor to work on this program, so thank you so much. Every time people ask me about it, I say it was the genius of Capricia Marshall and Hillary Clinton that created this program. That's just, it's a brilliant program, and it makes so much sense on so many levels, and it's so exciting to work on. You know, there are constantly, like, different opportunities coming our way because there's so many different directions you can grow this program. We just heard a little bit about the formal diplomacy aspect of the program, which is when we have high-level officials coming in. It was a brilliant idea to do that. We actually recently had, I guess it was almost a year ago, the president of France came for a state visit, and I desperately wanted to do New Orleans cuisine because New Orleans cuisine is so deeply rooted in French cuisine, but so uniquely American at the same time. And so we brought John Besh, who's an amazing chef from New Orleans. Mm-hmm. And I promised everyone it'll be New Orleans, but it'll be elevated New Orleans for this very fancy lunch that we do. And he absolutely knocked it out of the park. And as Capricia said, we started this whole structure of bringing the chef in to meet the world leader and the Secretary of State and Vice President Biden. So it's this great honor for the chef to also get to meet these folks before the meal is served. And President Hollande came in, and he just sort of flew into the room and went right for John Besh. And our chefs wear these State Department chef jackets. They're another brilliant idea. They're navy blue, and they have a State Department seal, and they look so official, and the chefs love them. But they only get them if they do something. You know, they don't just get them for being in the program. They have to travel with us or do one of these high-level events. So they're very coveted, and it makes them want to participate even more, which is a great idea. President Hollande went right for him and started chatting with him, and John Besh explained that he was from New Orleans. And President Hollande said, oh, the president was just talking to me about New Orleans this morning. And it was just like you said, like this, the light went off, and I was like, oh, yeah, this is great. You know, he absolutely got it. He was so happy. He felt so honored that all this thought had been put into his meal, and he ate every bit of it. Mm-hmm. And it was really wonderful. So it did exactly what you said. It was wonderful. The other aspect of the program is we work with a different division of the State Department called the International Information Programs. And they have a U.S. speaker program that's been around since the 50s. And the program sends speakers out to the U.S. embassies. And the embassies send in requests for the type of speaker that they're interested in having. We've been very fortunate that this chef program has taken off like wildfire. I think we had like one or two trips, and all the embassies started talking to each other. And so they are able to request chefs from our program as speakers. And they bring them out to their post, and they are able to design the type of program that really checks the boxes of what they're trying to achieve in their country. Some countries want to focus on
women or the underserved communities or young business owners. The remarkable thing about chefs is that they don't just cook food. They do so much. I mean, that's the part we love the most, I'm not gonna lie. But they are activists in their communities. I have a chef that I work with who is teaching on sustainability at Harvard. They are very knowledgeable in what's going on with our environment. They are business owners, so they can talk about entrepreneurship. Female business owners. It's really really wonderful because for the embassies, they get so many different topics that they can program while our chefs are out there. The other benefit is that chefs get a lot of press when they travel, and so it gives the embassy an opportunity to promote the U.S. in a really positive way and reach so many people all at once. I mean, it's all about spreading a positive message of America as far and wide as possible. And you have one chef on, you know, the Good Morning America of this country, and millions of people just saw this wonderful engagement and someone talking about the United States and talking about their food heritage. Everyone's culture is in their food, as everybody knows, and it's this remarkable way to connect with other people in a very non-political, non-threatening way. To really get to know somebody and to know a little bit about, you know, the people of their country. So we've had some really wonderful trips. We've done almost, I'd say, over 30 trips now. And some of them have been absolutely remarkable. We had a chef go to Pakistan, a female chef, Mary Sue Milliken, went to Pakistan. And who knew, but they have a food network in Pakistan. Food is huge there. Our embassy, as you would imagine, can't do a lot of programming in Pakistan, and I would suggest that our image is probably not, you know, the American image is probably not very positive in Pakistan. And this chef went with her State Department chef jacket, and she was hosted by this very prominent female chef in Pakistan who traveled around Pakistan with her to different markets and different villages and towns, teaching our chef about their culture. So it's not an American coming in saying, this is what we do and this is how we do it, but learning about them. And also talking a little bit about her food culture and her history and her family stories. And they traveled around and they were followed by a film crew who they then put together a mini reality TV show around this visit. And it aired, millions of viewers tuned in to watch this program during Ramadan, actually. And it was, you know, the embassy, I mean, they have never really reached an audience that wide with such a positive message before. So we've really started doing these TV shows, actually. You know, it started actually with Duff Goldman. I don't know if you all know Duff Goldman. He's the Ace of Cakes guy, and he is totally wild and funny, but very appropriate when he travels with us, which I'm very grateful for. But he went to Algeria, and thousands of people came out to see him in Algeria. Baking is very prominent there. It's very popular in their cuisine. And thousands of people came out because his show is in syndication in Algeria. Like, who would have thought? You know what I mean? So all these people came out, and a film crew actually followed him around. That's where we started with this idea. They followed him around, and they made it into a reality TV show. And again, millions of viewers watched him in Algeria, and even surrounding countries picked up the show as well. So it was really tremendous. Just the reach of this program has been very surprising and very exciting. We've had some estimates. We had a chef in Hong Kong, and I think they estimated like 11 million people had either read about him, seen him on TV, gone to they did a barbecue festival. It was just really, really remarkable.
So Lauren, you told me something interesting. Last year we had an event related to this, and I was thinking a little bit about when we asked a young Norwegian chef who was born after all these wars and was cooking for the ambassador. We asked him, you know, what does your ambassador ask you to cook when you have foreign guests in Washington? And the first thing he thought of was in Norway, there is a program called Dining with the Enemy. And it is apparently a very popular series where Norwegian chefs go out to conflict zones and learn about how people cook in different areas and then bring that back. So what you're talking about is, of course, not only in the United States, but in other countries also, this deep curiosity about something that connects humanity, this ability to consume food, to share culture, to sit around a table, commensality as it's called in Latin, is so important to our diplomacy. But we have sitting next to you Mexico's culinary diplomat in Washington, Patty Hinnich, who has her own story to tell about her role in popularizing and also elevating Mexican cuisine, which is, by the way, a UNESCO World Heritage cuisine, something we could talk about diplomatically. The United States does not recognize intangible cultural property, but nevertheless, Mexico is a very important part of this promotion because food and the culture of Mexico, particularly the culinary culture, is important. And Patty, I think single-handedly in the United States has done so much to elevate the elements of that wonderful indigenous cuisine to American tasters. And I am a beneficiary personally, but also many of you probably have seen her terrific series, Patty's Mexican Table. Oh. But it was a journey, and I think I'd like you to tell
thank
our audience about
so
that, Patty.
Thank you so much. And I want to thank you for having me on. And
I feel
incredibly honored to be in this panel with all of you. And Joanna, I know I do have a show on PBS. PBS does not do any marketing or PR, so I think I need to hire you.
to help me promote my show.
I need a second career, so I think this would be great.
Thank
I'll
you,
your,
thank you so
I'll
much.
I'll be your promoter, but I think you have plenty in this town.
So talking about conflict zones and wars, and you were talking in the beginning about how all these restaurants flourish whenever the U.S. is in conflict with a certain country, I think Mexico has the most unique relationship with the U.S., because when you think about the war, the big war was so long ago. And yet we have the biggest diaspora of Mexicans in the US. And it is such an incredibly noble and delicious and, you know, so rewarding way for the countries to get to know one another. But it is incredibly complex. And I'll tell you a little bit about my personal journey with it and how much I have changed as the years have gone by. So here's a Mexican who moves to the US for just a couple years. I married a Mexican who happened to be born in the US, but because his parents were studying here and then he moved back to Mexico, we moved to the US and we were gonna be here just for a couple years. We come from really close-knit families, so we wanted to get away just for a little. To start off, here's my como decimos, sin coladera. Mm-hmm. I have no strainer. Like, whatever goes from here goes there. And then it was 2 years, and then we were in Texas, and I grew insanely nostalgic about Mexican food and Mexican cuisine and all that it meant to me. And Texas is a funny limbo for a Mexican because you get there, and it looks a little Mexican. You know, the terrain looks a little bit Mexican, but no. People talk in Spanish, and many come from Mexico, but it doesn't sound like the Mexican Spanish that I know. You go to Mexican authentic restaurants, and you're gonna eat that enchilada, and something's like, what? You know, it's not the Mexican I know. So in the beginning, that's what drew me into the kitchen, because I wanted to make the Mexican food that I had grown up with, that had nurtured me, and that I was insanely nostalgic, that's the truth, and I was homesick because I have a very workaholic husband, not that I am not. But so that's what got me into cooking, and I started cooking all these Mexican homestyle dishes and food, and something fascinating started to happen because I come from Mexico City, which is the big metropolis in Mexico. Mexicans are what, you know, we're called in a slang, sort of a derogatory way, as chilangos, which is like New Yorkers. Here, I think. So people that are born and are raised in Mexico City really don't go to the rest of the country that much because it is like the belly button of the country. Mm. You have people from everywhere coming to Mexico. You have restaurants from everywhere into Mexico City. See, I'm even referring to Mexico City as Mexico. How crazy is that? Being in Texas, I started connecting with all these Mexicans from all these different regions that I had never traveled into. and really, you know, sharing recipes. I would go into a supermarket and I heard Spanish, and I would ask, are you Mexican from where? How do you make your rice? I can't make the right rice, you know. And I started making all these recipes from the rest of the country, and hence, many years later, 12 years later, I was a political analyst historian, had a sort of an existential crisis early on, left that world, got into cooking, studied cooking, and started teaching Mexican cooking. So I wanted to share true Mexican, traditional, authentic food. And that's how I started at the Mexican Cultural Institute. Every week that has gone by, I've been humbled by how little I know. By how little I know of my own country. I mean, I think I know, you know, the northern region because I studied it. I can tell you every single governor, because that was my thesis, the governors of Brazil, of the state and the conflicts and all the textbooks. And I thought I knew the cuisine, but I go back and there's been some fusion. There's been new ways of using the ingredients. People don't stay static as how you studied them 50 years ago. So I've learned so much from my own country. It's brought me closer to my country because I've had this hunger to go back to Mexico and really know the different regions and people. And on the other hand, talking about building bridges between Mexico and the US, I started sharing Mexican, but living here, I've connected with so many Mexicans that have been here one generation, two, three, and are Mexican Americans, which is not the same as Mexicans. And I know that because I have Mexican American kids. And so in the beginning, when they were first little, they really wanted to blend in. They didn't want to speak any Spanish at home, especially my oldest one. When people asked us in the street, you know, are you Mexican? Because I have a little bit of an accent. They have an accent in Spanish. So whenever we go to Mexico, I'm like, see? They don't understand you here either. But so when they asked us, you know, where you're from, and I would say, I'm Mexican, they would say, no, ma, you're Mexican, we're American. In the beginning, it was like, you know, it was like shocking, you know, and we've compromised. Now, I love it when I see them tearing up with the American anthem. Mm. It is so moving to me. And after 18 years of being here, as I say in my Twitter thing, I'm happily torn between two countries that I adore. And I've grown to know the Mexican communities in the U.S., and I have learned that Mexican cuisine, we are no longer living in a time where Mexican cuisine or good Mexican food can only be found south of the border. I'm sorry, I've had some of the best Mexican food in Los Angeles. And no longer can you say that Tex-Mex food is a bad imitation of Mexican food. I even wrote an article for the Washington Post, sort of apologizing, saying, you know, when I first went to San Antonio 18 years ago, I thought, what is this? I make Tex-Mex chili all the time. You know, I add a little bit more jalapeno now, but. So Tex-Mex is its own regional cuisine, and it's fabulous, and it's getting even better. And you have Tex-Mex, Cal-Mex, New York-Mex, Chicago-Mex, Fresh-Mex. And so it's like, it's become porous. So regional cuisine is evolving south of the border, but also north of the border, and many people are threatened by it. You know, are we Mexican? Are we American? Who are we allied to? What is? And if you lose the fear and you realize that we're living in a different time where Mexican food in the US, it's a gorgeous thing. You know, you have Mexicans that call, I talk too much. Tell me when to stop.
No, but you always say fascinating things. One of the things that I thought about as you spoke is that the anthropologist, sort of the godfather of all of this culinary history, is a very wonderful sociologist and anthropologist named Sidney Mintz. And I want to read you his definition of cuisine, because it's exactly what you said. He says, a cuisine is not a set of recipes aggregated in a book, or a series of particular foods associated with a particular setting. A cuisine requires a population that eats that cuisine with sufficient frequency to consider themselves expert on it. They believe and care about it, they know what it should consist of and how to make it and how it should taste. And in short, a genuine cuisine has common social roots. It is the food of a community, albeit a very large one. And that is actually exactly what you're describing here, so that in the cultural anthropology field, what you've just told our audience tonight is exactly what you understand now from this journey you took in teaching Mexican cuisine.
I mean, just to close it, the incredible thing is that, yes, you know, you have these communities of Mexicans that, for whatever reason, during whichever historical period, whereas it was the people from Zacatecas who one day woke up and they happened to be in the U.S., because, you know, suddenly that part of Mexico was now the U.S., to more recent Mexicans from a few generations back who are in Chicago. And the thing is, they come to the U.S. or they've been here for 3 or 4 generations or 10 generations, and they have their tools, their recipes, the basic cuisine and skills that they use, and they mix them with the new roots and the new land that they grow to love and incorporate. And there's new regional cuisines. And so what that says about how we can improve the relationship between Mexicans and Americans, and the understanding of the Mexican government, of the Mexicans that live here, they're not the same as the ones that are there, and vice versa. For me, it's been incredibly humbling.
Well, I think you've really made a great transition to our last panelists and organizers, Zoe Kosumidu, who professionally has been a diplomat all her career, but also tells us about how food has become a uniting factor among all of us. And I think what's interesting, Zoe, is in the United States, when people thought of foreign food before all of this took place, we thought of French cuisine, we thought about Italian food as it came in, although it was considered the food of the enemy during World War II, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. We thought about all of these different cuisines of the Western Europe. Greek cuisine was not often up there, because not because it wasn't terrific, it's because people didn't know what existed except in church festivals if they went to them. But you are a culinary diplomat in your own right, and perhaps you could round us out with the practice, as Ambassador Marshall did, of how you see it in Europe.
Yeah. Well, I'll try to keep the balance here, accent-wise, and two, so you don't feel lonely. And as a career diplomat, I have been trying to represent not only my country, but also as a member of a group of 28 countries. Remember that these ladies here just represented one country, and I have to represent 28, so that's quite cheers here. All together, for many years, we have been putting together programs, joint programs, to promote the European culture and values, not only as a whole, but also individually. So we have succeeded in putting very, very successful programs, and namely, they were and they still are the EU Open House. I hope, if anybody of you around here knows about it, the reason I'm mentioning is because we're very close to the next EU Open House, which will happen this Saturday, May 9th, to celebrate Europe Day. And what happens is that we all, the embassies, open our doors, our house, it's an open house, remember, to all Americans, to all visitors, all guests who like to visit an embassy and never had the chance to do it otherwise before. And not only to just visit it, but also to taste the flavor of the country, the art of the country, to get the experience without a passport, without traveling. And that's how we also started the idea of Passport DC. That was in collaboration with Culture DC back in 2007. Other programs that we have put together was the May European Month of Culture, which is this program part of the European Month of Culture. The Euro Night that the French Embassy was hosting for about 5 years, but it unfortunately has stopped. The EU Kids Festival and the European Union Film Festival at the American Film Institute. So if you haven't guessed which of all these programs that I mentioned was the most popular one, I have to tell you that it was the European Union open house. And that was because we all the embassies, served culinary delicacies, and it was a feast of gastronomic feast. So it was very much appreciated by all the guests, and we had very, very long lines, hours and hours of wait outside of each embassy. Actually, we had hired buses who would commute and transfer visitors from one embassy to the other. And believe it or not, within 6 hours, about 100,000 visitors are visiting our embassies in order to try and taste flavors of each country. Same thing was happening with Euronight. That was an evening of feast and celebration. And with dances, but mainly food. And food is the magic word. Why? You may wonder. Not only because it was so well explained by our previous panelists here, but also because it's the main theme at Expo 2015 in Milan, where 140 countries are participating, with each one with an individual pavilion, and a very, very impressive one is the United States one, which I was very lucky to visit at the day of the opening last Friday, very, very fresh, like a few days ago. And I was honored to be welcomed by Dorothy Hamilton, who was in charge of the pavilion. So I'm just mentioning because I see that our fellow panelists here are recognizing the person and the venue, right?
President of the International Culinary Center in New York, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah. In addition, I have to congratulate the Italian pavilion, which was, of course, the host, but one of the very top ones, and my colleagues from the Italian Cultural Institute are here, so congratulations. So, so far, my job was to promote culture and the arts, and as was the job of my colleagues from the other 27 countries, but all this changed route when one time in one of our monthly meetings, we had the honor to welcome a fellow panelist. And here's where our paths are crossing once again after 3 years. That was Lauren Burstein. And I'm so glad to see you again. And I'd like to thank you publicly because you are the inspiration for this idea, and that's why you're here now. And
it's actually Natalie.
Since then, actually, Lorraine was mentioning all the wonderful accomplishments of the French and Italian cuisines and their exchanges with chefs and the incredible presence of restaurants that represent Italian and French cuisine in the United States. So at some point, I was kind of disappointed a little bit. So I raised my hand and said, well, we all know that Italian and French cuisine are very well famous and known everywhere, but there are other cuisines that are worth mentioning and also not promoted, but at least given a chance to have represent the values and the country. So I've been inspired by this wonderful presentation that she did that day, and I started myself working on a project that was called Health, Nutrition, and Fitness from Hippocrates until now. And that was including presentation of Greek cuisine, Greek healthy cuisine, with an array of presenters and scientific presenters most of the time, athletes, chefs that were doing cooking demonstrations. And it became so popular that one day the phone rang and it was a congressman's, US congressman's office calling me, and the person who did the call is in the audience today, and I would like to thank her once again. And she asked me, why don't you just take this program to the Congress? We'll be delighted to host it. So it happened on December 3rd, 2013. We had a presentation of the healthy Greek cuisine, and it was a huge success. And I just realized how true the words of Lauren Burstein were when she was saying how important it was to present food as an opener, as a discussion, as a dialogue opener. And for us, it was a big, big honor and a very accurate application of the words that I've heard and was inspired by Lauren Burstein. So I would like to thank you once again for that inspirational presentation that you have done.
I was also joined by our Deputy Chief of Protocol, Natalie Jones, so she was also, I can't take all the credit.
What?
She's not here, go ahead.
She's not here, so you take the credit.
And this isn't being live streamed.
Right. Well, I think she'll never know.
But you know, it's really what you're describing is something that I think every panelist has mentioned, and that is the power of food to humanize culture. Mm. And whether it's the Japanese vice president, or whether it's Prime Minister Netanyahu, or whether it's Michael John Besh of New Orleans telling the French how to cook their food in a nice way in a New Orleans style, or them recognizing the uniqueness, or the Mexican varieties that we have inside our borders as well as cross-border. I think food is one of the things that really knows no borders. And all of you have talked but not mentioned the impact of globalization on our diets, healthy and unhealthy, is a very powerful factor in getting people across the globe to be able to use food as a powerful tool of cultural diplomacy. So it might be useful at this time to have some of our audience who've been very patient see if they have comments of their own, because we've dominated the floor for a while, and I can't believe there aren't some people here who have some things to say. So we're taking, yes, sir.
Ambassador Marshall and Lauren, talk about the connection between your activities and that of Bruce Lee's Let's Move.
I think she's been a little bit criticized for the taste of some of the healthy choices that have been given to students, but that's where they really first learn about cuisines and are exposed to different cultures, and food, of course, is a great way to do that. Have you made that leap, that bridge? Thank you.
Oh, absolutely, thank you. And I have found everything that's served at the White House absolutely delicious.
It's because they have a woman chef.
Yes, they do. But it is immediately upon thinking through this program and what we were going to do, we did reach out to both Sam and Chris, the two White House chefs at the time. And Sam Cass was assisting the First Lady in developing the Let's Move program and the garden outside. He was sort of in charge of making sure that the garden was growing and in order. And we really worked with them, because you can't quite create a program like this without discussing and getting a sound advice from the true professionals. And so they really worked with us on how to roll out this program, and then how could we marry it up with them? What were opportunities that we could do together? And they came and they spoke at our events, the launch event that we had. Both Chris and Sam were there. Chris was really highlighted at that event. And throughout it all, they have been wonderful partners in giving us guidance. And I know that then thereafter, When Lauren started to work with the individual chefs, they were assisting in that effort as well. There was one wonderful event that they created. It was this with the chef de chef. Yes?
Le Club de Chef.
Le Club de Chef. Yes. And where all of the chefs who serve presidents, prime ministers, royalty from around the world gather and they have a discussion. And so they brought them all together and we engaged in a phenomenal conversation about what everyone was doing in their particular homes and exchanging thoughts and ideas and questioning some of the food that was being served, but it was a phenomenal exchange that they initiated, and particularly Chris, I think, really led that effort.
Yes,
and they have just been tremendous advisors, guide, and partners in this effort.
But you know, I wanted to comment, this is a great question on healthy food, because Zoe, you come from the country that invented healthy cuisine, and it's really the Mediterranean food which is now again recognized as one of the best and healthy ways to sustain your health. So I think all chefs take into consideration today the value of good health and good eating. And even these young children we saw from Slovenia, who we should all give a hand to. I don't know.
Did you try their dumplings?
Yes, I did. It was not a dumpling. It was
delicious.
It was a boiled strudel.
Well, it was a boiled strudel, but I asked them, I said, what can you compare it to? And they said, your dumpling.
Yeah, but they were just darling. So if you haven't had a chance, I mean, they were just a wonderful group. I saw there was a gentleman who had his hand up there.
It's a wonderful idea. I think food could be a very good tool in the diplomacy toolkit. It's a source of, it's a great pacifier, a great uniter, but also it's a great source of vitriol, which is evident in the rest of the world today, where 64 countries ban or require labeling for the kind of food that's predominant here, which is GMOs. I'm reminded of after the Haitian earthquake, which killed 2,000 or 3,000 people, the farmers were given a huge load of Monsanto seed. They took it to the town square and ceremonially burned it, calling it seeds of death. I'm also reminded of a group of celebrity chefs, which you mentioned earlier, that went on TV recently on national television and said that organic is the way to go, we should label GMOs. And does this imply that we're going to start using organic food as a showpiece in diplomacy in order to further our interests overseas?
Well, it's a very interesting question. Chefs are advocates, and they are very involved in that movement. They lobby on the Hill, and it's, for the most part, it's for labeling, transparency. They haven't necessarily taken on, you know, the fight against GMOs, but that they're properly labeled. We just recently, I guess about a week and a half ago, hosted our first ever development day for chefs in our program, and the first panel discussion was about U.S. foreign food policy. And we had people from USAID and Foreign Agriculture Service and every different sort of division of foreign food policy come in. And it was this really wonderful open discussion. And the idea was for the chefs to learn a little bit about U.S. foreign food policy and why we're doing it and what the issues are with GMOs in impoverished countries and trying to feed billions of people. Also, you know, opportunity for the chefs to throw all their questions at these folks. And it was a really lively discussion. And when our chefs travel, they promote, we promote two White House initiatives. One is to promote tourism, culinary tourism to the US, but the other is to promote US food products. Those food products are always raw material food products, never processed food products. So it'll be something like Alaskan cod or peanuts or, you know, from California or whatever. But it's very important that in our program, the chefs are not the mouthpiece for U.S. foreign food policy or any kind of food policy. They don't have to travel and agree with all of our policies. That's not really what the program's about. It's more about this cultural exchange. You know, we do like to use this opportunity because it makes so much sense when you're in a country and you're trying to promote a great U.S. food product that we plug it into what the chefs are already cooking along with local ingredients that they're using as well. But the chefs don't have to do that. It's not something that's forced on them. We've never had a chef decide not to work with these products because they are great products. But the GMO issue has not been an issue for our program because we don't really tackle that. It's a big question. It's a big issue. But we are working with our chefs to have that discussion and make it a more open discussion.
Yes.
A couple of comments.
I think you need to, can you wait for the microphone?
Sure.
Patty, a couple of comments for you. One, you and Zoe need to get together. You have the PBS connection. You've got 28 embassies. You need to do a television show that shows inside the kitchen of every embassy.
People here,
people in D.C. will just eat it up. No pun intended. We love all that. But Patty, since you're a native Mexican, and we have lovely Rick Bayless in Chicago, who's a native, a natural American, who spends so much time in Mexico, do you guys share notes? Number one. And then for the rest of the panel, a thought going forward, and you kind of touched on it already, but that was along the lines of about healthy foods and really trying to exploit what are the healthy diets from around the globe. It's not just what's the Mediterranean in Greece. There are lots of healthy opportunities in all the countries, not just the EU member states, but our own country and all others. So if you could make some comments on that, would be great.
In regards to Rick Bayless, I admire him deeply. He's an incredible chef. He's done so much for Mexican cuisine and for, you know, showing America about, just like Diana Kennedy, they're pioneers in the field. His show is either after or before mine on PBS all the time. We're not together. We know each other very well, and I think we like each other very well, and we have very different ways of approaching our you know, topics, which I think makes for wonderful diversity.
But the question was, if
we don't exchange notes.
Oh,
no.
Yeah.
No.
But I really think that this is the uniqueness also in the United States that I just love, that you can have two tremendous chefs who create Mexican cuisine, but so different, and with a different fusion and a different mix. It's fantastic. And to watch, I don't know if you've had the opportunity to go to Chicago and taste Rick's food. I mean, it's phenomenal. It's wonderful. Right. And Patty, oh my gosh, I'm so excited. Like, I don't eat for 2 days before I go to eat it, because so I can eat absolutely everything again and again. But it's unique. Each one is so unique. I think that's what's so fabulous about our country, is just all these fusions of other colors.
And that's
of other
what
countries.
It is incredible.
Right.
It's very unique to the United States.
So
it's really magical.
It is, though, isn't it?
Yes.
I would like to add that part of culinary diplomacy originating from governments, it's also addressing other issues like rebranding or changing a discussion about an famous topic. And there's a very recent example. I read an article on Peru, mm-hmm. the Peruvians. Diplomacy, culinary diplomacy, that they're starting to promote their food, their cuisine, very aggressively, not only as a new cuisine, but also as a way of rebranding their name as a country, their image as a country, and also for development purposes, for economic development, by exporting products, and also by creating more opportunities for cultural and culinary tourism.
Nation branding is the name of the game, and the Peruvians have done a wonderful job. And
yes.
It has actually not only been something at the upper levels of government, but it has touched all parts of society, in the growers, in the relationship between chefs, in the training of poor young mm-hmm. men and women from the barrios, from the communities, who are learning to become chefs as a credible profession. It is an incredible transformation. And also the government of Thailand has been doing this.
Mm-hmm.
The Korean government is involved
yeah.
in culinary diplomacy. The Taiwanese, who don't have many people that recognize them anymore, hold an annual competition. It's full of Latino chefs because they're still the main countries that recognize them. But it's amazing that culinary diplomacy is this fascinating tool. I've been told that we have time for one more question before we let our panel wrap up. Yes, this lady in the back.
Not really.
No.
Screen? Unfortunately, it's not going to go to the live stream, so I think that you need the mic.
Hello?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, thank you for coming to speak to us today. It's been a pleasure to hear each of your insightful stories. My question has to do with the other side of cultural diplomacy, Americans on the receiving end. For those, there are many, many Americans outside of the metropolitan centers of Chicago, New York, LA, DC, who may not have the opportunity to try specific cuisines from other countries or have that exposure or awareness that there are countries beyond our borders. So my question is, are there any initiatives, outreach that is being made to reach those smaller pockets of Americans in smaller towns who may not have the opportunity to try these foods and to build that into a dialogue on learning foreign languages, remaining educated, building education on international development activities, histories, et cetera. So using food to build on that dialogue. That's my question.
I appreciate your question, even though I'm not a panelist, because when I started the idea of creating conflict cuisines, it was not only because we lived in Washington and we had a plethora of opportunities, but I believe, and everywhere I've gone in our country, I'm sure you share this, there's always at least a Mexican restaurant and a Chinese restaurant everywhere.
And a Greek restaurant.
You don't, all you need is
lots
true,
of Greek.
And souvlaki is very popular everywhere.
And Zoe
too.
But the point is, you can train people around the world. The goal of coming around the table is to integrate community, so that the Mexican restaurant is not left off to the side and that's where people go at the end of the day, that people who like Mexican food will meet the owners, will have an opportunity to engage, to taste something. It may not be the high-level food of a Rick Bayless or a Parihanich, but the same with Chinese food. There are wonderful articles written by second and third generation Chinese diaspora who talk about the evolution and the dynamism of their cuisine. There's a fabulous article about General Tso's chicken because nobody knows where it started, but it's all over the United States. And I recommend that you follow some of these articles because food is dynamic, as everyone has mentioned. It is not a static phenomena. Mm. And that is why when communities have divisions, people should share a common table, whether it's Baltimore or Ferguson or anywhere. I think there's opportunities not only in our foreign relations, but in our national domestic relations to improve relations with communities. Awesome. I want to give the panelists a chance for the last word. I don't want the last word. Ambassador Marshall, if you would like to say anything or add, or we can talk to people at a reception also. But
absolutely.
Laura, please.
And I see that we're getting the let's move on. But I would just say thank you. But to reiterate what you said, we are all ambassadors. And we should have that type of outreach and that interest in other cultures, as well as expressing our own. It is that, I think, wonderful exchange of cultures that begin these relationships. And it's at that base, it's at that level where we can really move the line in our friendships around the world. We have a lot of issues. We have problems in many spots of the world. And by sometimes just sharing a meal with someone and getting to know them, and by telling them a bit more about who you are as an American, can really create a new bridge of understanding.
Excellent. Lauren?
I think that was pretty much the best way to end this.
Patty.
I will just say one thing quickly to your question. I think also what's changing is in these communities, these small towns, if they don't have a lot of cultural diversity, what we've seen in this country is this boom of food television. And you see folks in these small towns who are talking about, you know, the levels of flavor in their food. It's amazing, right? Like, they're watching food TV, and they're experiencing food, though they're not tasting it. And they're speaking like chefs, and they're tasting food like chefs, and they're getting to experience food from other countries and other cultures. And there are a lot of, you know, Anthony Bourdain and Andrew Zimmern, and now Michael Voltaggio has a show. Mm-hmm. You know, this is changing, you know, this country, this food, you know, revolution. So I think that will also make a big difference in having people experience those cultures.
They're watching Patty.
They're watching Patty. I hope. No, I think completely agree, and I think that it is of course, in the country-to-country big-level meetings, but I think it's mostly in the neighbor-to-neighbor. With this language and these new bridges and communications that you're talking about, you know, these food shows that anywhere, in any little town, people are watching, we're breaking myths about what a Mexican looks like. Yes, I am a Mexican. You know, they've asked me so many times, but you don't really look like, you don't really know. And so I have shows that share, you know, some episodes. I go to Mexico and share about Mexican food in Mexico. But then I have Mexican Americana shows where I go here to DC or to New York and talk with Americans that are reinterpreting what they want to make of Mexican food or the new kinds of Mexican food that's happening here, right next to you. And the best thing of it all is, I think, that you teach people that they can go to the supermarket and get that jicama and get that tomatillo and get that, maybe grown here, maybe grown there, but they're enriching their table with all of what immigrants have brought and continue to bring. And the other way goes, because people that come here and that are here, we also need to be humbled and say, America isn't what I thought it was. I've learned so much about regional US cuisines that I had no idea the level of depth and diversity and richness. So I think it goes both ways.
So Zoe, should we open the embassy kitchens up and follow this lady's recommendation as part
absolutely,
of
absolutely, absolutely. But I need. I would like to close this wonderful symposium with a Greek word that I just mentioned, and that is symposium. That means drinking together, and does not only mean drinking together. It also means eating and getting together. And not only healthy food is part of a healthy living and a lifestyle, but company with friends and family is what makes the good life, the feast and the celebration of life. And today we're having a celebration here with all of you, panelists, host, and the audience. And the conclusion will be at the table, which is offered kindly by NYU and restaurant Cup Nose that will serve Greek food. So you're all welcome to follow up at the reception and have a taste of Greek food. Finally, it's becoming popular.
I just need to say something, you know, and it's super and mild today, right? And it's super mild, and it is really ironic, just to close, that Cinco de Mayo is so huge in the U.S. and not in Mexico. It's insane.
Thank you all.
Thank you. That was great.